Hello, everybody. You're listening to Let's Master English, and my name is Coach Shane. Hello, everybody. Welcome back to Let's Master English. This is podcast 46. And once again, I'm your English coach, Coach Shane. Thank you so much for downloading and listening to the podcast. Today we have an amazing story. For some of you, this story might make you angry. It might make you sad. But for sure, it will touch your feelings. It's an amazing story. We have a couple of facts from Country Shane, and we'll be curious about you and your country. Country Shane always has something interesting. We have five questions from you guys, some fantastic questions. And the book club, as you know, that is a separate podcast now. If you follow here, you can get that. I hope that you're enjoying the book club. It's free to anyone. And a special announcement for Perf, my speaking class, at the very end. Oof, enough chit-chat. Let's get this party started. Happy older couples live in fear of one day soon having to live alone. The thought of losing one's better half after over 50 years is too much for many, and one couple in Belgium has solved that very problem. They'll go together in an assisted suicide. Neither is suffering a terminal illness, but they have just received government approval to their macabre request due to the potential of severe emotional duress. When's their last kiss? February 3rd, 2015, their 64th wedding anniversary. Wow, this is actually big news. Did you hear about this story? Well, let's listen again and let's... The subject is familiar, but why is this story such big news? Let's listen again. Happy older couples live in fear of one day soon having to live alone. The thought of losing one's better half after over 50 years is too much for many. And one couple in Belgium has solved that very problem. They'll go together in an assisted suicide. Neither is suffering a terminal illness, but they have just received government approval to their macabre request due to the potential of severe emotional duress. When's their last kiss? February 3rd, 2015, their 64th wedding anniversary. Boy, is this a happy story or a sad story? Does this story make you feel good or make you feel concerned? Does it maybe anger you? Are you disappointed? What's your reaction to this story? So the main subject here is assisted suicide. Okay, so suicide means to kill oneself. And I think we can all agree that suicide is a terrible subject, and it's something that most of us think is not good. And for people who are religious, in fact, I think for most religions, it's not allowed. So this is not a nice subject. But here it's not just suicide, it's assisted suicide. And what that means is a doctor, usually a doctor, helps the person end their life. And they do this in a very comfortable method, usually by an injection or a pill, and the person simply falls asleep. Now, when we talk about assisted suicide, we always think about someone who is suffering from a very terrible disease, and it's causing them great physical pain, and they want to stop the pain. Now, usually in most countries, if they allow assisted suicide, doctors must agree that this person, anyway, has very few months to live. So they're trying to actually help the person. But in this case, in this story, it's not one person, it's two people, a married couple, and neither of them is sick. They're not going to die soon. I mean, who knows? I mean, you might die tomorrow. They might die in 3 months. But if you look at their health, they should continue living as they are. There's no forecast of death. However, they have chosen to die together with the assistance of a doctor. And they chose their date. And the reason they want to die together is because living alone, living without the other, they argued, would be too stressful. It would be too horrible. And the government in Belgium agreed. Wow. So as far as I know, this is the first healthy, not only person, but the first healthy couple to get government approval to die. Now, granted, these people, they're not young. They're well into their 80s. They have been married over 63 years. So we can understand that, yes, the end is probably not that far away. But who knows? Maybe they could live another 20 years, 25 years. Maybe they could be very happy together. Their decision. They made the decision. And the government agreed. And they've decided that February 3rd, next year, will be their last kiss. Wow. Let's check out the story line by line. Happy older couples live in fear of one day soon having to live alone. To live in fear of something, how terrible. To live each day with the fear of something terrible happening. To live each day with being afraid that something terrible might happen. In this case, what is that terrible thing? Having to live alone, being required to live alone, having no choice but to live alone because their partner has died. Happy older couples. Sure. Absolutely. It's interesting. Have you heard the stories? And this is actually kind of common. For example, the wife dies in March, and the husband dies a few weeks later. Or vice versa, the husband dies in June, and 3 days later, the wife dies. I think it's a sign of love. I don't know, maybe not. But when the couple loves each other to the end, and they're at the end of their life, imagining waking up without that person, oh, it must be horrible. It truly must be a fear. The next sentence. The thought of losing one's better half after over 50 years is too much for many. The thought, the idea, the notion of losing one's better half, one's spouse, one's partner. Now, usually, when we talk about younger couples, the better half is the wife, and the worst half is the husband. Because we know, usually, women are better people than men. Not always, of course. But that's the idea. My better half generally means my wife. But for a happy couple, especially an older couple, one's better half simply means your husband or your wife. And the thought of losing one's better half to death after over 50 years, can you imagine being with one person over 50 years? I hope they're happy. That's a long time to be together. So we can assume that they are happy. And the thought of losing one's better half after over 50 years is too much for many. The thought of that is too much. It's overwhelming. It's too terrible. And one couple in Belgium, just north of France, has solved that very problem. That's a problem for many couples, and one couple in Belgium, they solved that specific problem, that precise problem, that exact problem. Next sentence. They'll go together in an assisted suicide. They will go together. Of course, in this case, go means die. They'll die together in an assisted suicide. A physician, a doctor, will help them go together. Neither, and for the pronunciation, we can also say neither. Neither, neither, both very common. Don't worry, say whichever comes naturally. Neither is suffering a terminal illness. Neither the man nor the woman, the husband or the wife, are sick. Now, a terminal illness actually means an illness which will take your life. A disease that will kill you. So we think of cancer as a terminal illness, but actually that's not necessarily true. Some cancers are just a problem. They just hang around for a long time and they don't necessarily kill you. You can treat it. But there are, like, for example, as far as I know, pancreatic cancer, which is your pancreas, P-A-N-C-R-E-A-S. As far as I know, pancreatic cancer can be terminal. Some cancers, of course, if they're fully developed, can be terminal. But the man and the woman, neither is suffering from a terminal illness, but they have just received government approval to their macabre request. The government has said, okay, you can have an assisted suicide. That was their macabre request. M-A-C-A-B-R-E. If you look at the word, it looks like macabre, but it's not macabre. Some people say macabre, but the typical pronunciation is simply macabre. Yeah, it's the spelling and the pronunciation do not match. I agree. But anyway, macabre, it's an adjective, and it means something that is horrible, scary, maybe even disgusting, because it involves death or blood. Something really terrible. So here, this happy couple made a request. Hello, yes, this is my husband and I.
Oh, it's such a lovely day. Yes, next year, February, we would like to die together. Is that possible? Thank you.
Wow. I'm sorry. You want to what together?
To die.
Yes, that's a macabre request. That is not a typical request. That's a scary request for most people. But they requested to die together from the government in Belgium, and the government said, yes, of course, please, die together. Why? But they have to give a reason, okay? You can't just say, oh, I'm tired of living, can I die? The government will say, no, of course. So in their request, they explained why. And the reasoning was because of the possibility of severe emotional duress. Severe, S-E-V-E-R-E, extreme. Emotional, your feelings. Duress, duress, D-U-R-E-S-S. Severe emotional duress, extreme emotional feelings that greatly and negatively influence one's life. Those really, really, really strong feelings that make you want to die, that make you very unhappy. And I think that would be the case. Once again, well, right now I'm not married, but if I were 85, 95 years old and very happily in love with my wife of 50 years, I would have to think that my death is coming soon, and what a terrible thing. I mean, if I died or my wife died, the other person would be lonely, so sad. That would be very stressful. So, I think we all agree that there definitely would be severe emotional duress. But should they be allowed assisted suicide together? That's the question. Anyway, in Belgium they said yes. So let's finish the story. When's their last kiss? When is their last kiss? And think about that. Think about it. It's very beautiful, but very sad. When is their last kiss? February 3rd, 2015, their 64th wedding anniversary. I'm very curious about your feelings, your reaction, your opinion, your thoughts to this story. Me? Well, I have to say that I respect their decision. I have no problems with their decision. That doesn't mean I agree, and it's a very personal decision. According to the family, the couple, the man and wife, they're actually very happy. And they're planning the rest of their life with much enthusiasm and happiness. Yeah, they're not sad. They're not sad. They are happy. I have a link to the article. It will be in the newsletter. Everybody, you can get the newsletter absolutely for free, of course. Just go to www.letsmasterenglish.com/trydddm, T-R-Y-D-D-M. And you have to, it's a double approval process, so you have to say, yes, I want this. You don't have to get the free DDM lessons. And every week we do send out the newsletter, which has the news story and all the links. It's a big story. For some people, it's a nice story. For some people, it's not a nice story. Once again, I'm very curious as to your opinion. Okay, let's look at the vocabulary and then listen to the story two more times. To live in fear of. To live each day with the fear of something happening. Having to. Being required to. Having no choice but to do something. The thought of, the idea of, the notion of. One's better half. For a young married couple, one's better half is the wife. But the older you get, one's better half becomes your spouse, your partner, your husband, or your wife. I apologize for my alarm. That very problem, that precise problem, that exact problem, an assisted suicide, S-U-I-C-I-D-E, ending one's life by decision and with the help of a medical professional. Another word that we sometimes use is euthanasia. But euthanasia is very scientific. Assisted suicide, much more personal. Sometimes we say a physician-assisted suicide. Some people use the term mercy killing, but that sounds really bad. Most people who accept this say assisted suicide. A terminal illness, an illness which will take your life. Macabre. M-A-C-A-B-R-E. Something that is horrible because it involves death. Due to, because of. Potential, possibility. Severe emotional duress. D-U-R-E-S-S. Extreme emotional feelings that greatly and negatively influence one's life. Those are the terms, expressions. I'm going to read it two more times. The first time, nice and smoothly. The second time, normal. Here we go. Happy older couples live in fear of one day soon having to live alone. The thought of losing one's better half after over 50 years is too much for many. And one couple in Belgium has solved that very problem. They'll go together in an assisted suicide. Neither is suffering a terminal illness, but they have just received government approval to their macabre request due to the potential of severe emotional duress. When's their last kiss? February 3rd, 2015, their 64th wedding anniversary. Happy older couples live in fear of one day soon having to live alone. The thought of losing one's better half after over 50 years is too much for many. And one couple in Belgium has solved that very problem. They'll go together in an assisted suicide. Neither is suffering a terminal illness, but they have just received government approval to their macabre request due to the potential of severe emotional duress. When's their last kiss? February 3rd, 2015, their 64th wedding anniversary.
How you doing, everybody? This is Country Shane, and I'm here to bring you the facts.
Assisted suicide is legal in five American states, Oregon, Washington, and Montana in the Northwest, New Mexico in the Southwest, and Vermont in the Northeast. 47% of Americans think it's okay, but 49% are against it. This has been Country Shane bringing you the facts. I think many people assume assisted suicide is not okay in the United States, but in fact, it is. 5 states approve of assisted suicide. And once again, the laws are pretty clear. Not anybody can just go do it. You have to have medical approval and, of course, state approval. Now, what was interesting about Country Shane's facts is this is a controversy. 47% of Americans think it's okay. 49% think it's not okay. So I'm curious, what about our Let's Master English podcast listeners? How many of you think assisted suicide is okay? And let's once again, let's make this definition clear. Assisted suicide, the definition that we're going to look at is the person must have a terminal illness. And the doctors, at least 2 doctors, must agree that the person will die within 6 months anyway, and the person is in a great deal of pain. That's the definition that they're using in America. Specifically, that's the definition in Oregon and Washington, and I think New Mexico too. I'm not really sure, but I think probably the definition is the same in all 5 states. So what's your opinion? What do you think? Is it okay or not okay? America, once again, 47%, it's okay. 49%, not okay. Country Shane, thank you very much for those very interesting facts.
It's question and answer time. My first question comes from Alexander Krizhanovsky. Hello, I'm a student from Russia. I have a question. Which pronunciation should I use? General American pronunciation or received pronunciation? Okay, general American, I call that standard American pronunciation. Received pronunciation, we call that British pronunciation, but actually there are many, many different types of British pronunciation, and the proper term is received pronunciation. The Queen's English, it would be very similar to that. Okay, it's a great question. Now, to be honest, Alexander, for most students, received pronunciation is actually easier to learn. It's true. I know that for a fact. After teaching students from around the world for years, it seems that students who focus only on British pronunciation do a pretty good job. However, unfortunately, if you ask me my opinion, I do recommend standard American pronunciation. And the reason is simple. Everywhere you go in the world, people are familiar with American TV shows, American movies, and pop music from America. It's true. So if you go to the UK, if you go to Australia, if you go to Ireland, if you go to Hong Kong, if you go to China, if you go to Korea, if you go to Japan, if you go to Sweden, if you go to Nicaragua, if you go to Brazil, if you go to Ethiopia, if you go to Ghana, if you go to Russia, if you go to Germany, wherever you go, people will be familiar with at least 1 or 2 American TV shows and probably a couple of movies and probably several songs. And those songs, movies, television shows,
proliferate. They send out that American pronunciation. So people who are learning English, they will listen to these shows, these songs, these programs, and they get used to the pronunciation. As an American, I have seriously never had a problem with a native English-speaking person understanding me. Whether that person was from New York, or Atlanta, or down south in Texas, or in England, or Ireland, Scotland, Wales, or even in Hong Kong, Singapore, Australia, New Zealand, the Philippines. Any place that English is spoken natively or almost natively, every person from that country has easily understood me. And the reason is simply because of Hollywood. So my recommendation to you, Alexander, standard American pronunciation. It's not easy, and it takes some coaching, it takes some time, but I think it's worth it. Okay, thank you for that question. It's a great question. Leo Silva has a question. It's actually two questions. The first one, my mouth hurts. The muscles in my mouth hurt when I speak English for a long time. Is that normal? Yes, it is. It is normal, Leo. It's what happens. You're training muscles. So, if you really work hard for a long period of time and you try to pronounce things very specifically and very perfectly, definitely you can have some sore muscles. Take a break. Take a break, buddy. Okay, and his next question was, what's the difference between started to and started plus ing? For example, I started to study English. I started studying English. Well, I can tell you they are the same. However, in America, it's much more common to say started plus ing. So if you want to make a habit of one of those expressions, stick with started plus ing. Okay? My next question comes from Yuan Chen. Coach Shane, how do you pronounce serious and series? That's a good question. The first word again, serious, S-E-R-I-O-U-S, three syllables, serious, serious. The tongue touches nothing, serious, serious, serious. The next word, series, two syllables, S-E-R-I-E-S, series, series. Once again, the tip of the tongue touches nothing, serious, series. Shane likes to watch a serious television series. Does that make sense? I don't know. I think it does. Thank you for the question, Yuan Chen. The next question comes from Quang Duong Bui. Would you tell me the pronunciation when there's an SH and an S next to each other? So, for example, finish speaking or was Shane. So we have finish, SH, speaking, then we have the S. So SHS. Finish speaking. The other example, was Shane. So we have the was, S. It's actually a Z, but S-Z, same idea. And then Shane, S-H. So we have an S-S-H. So what is the pronunciation when you have the S-H and the S next to each other or the S and the S-H next to each other? Well, actually, I always talk about this in my DDM classes. This is a very important part of linking, and the simple answer is when similar sounds are next to each other, you should link and focus on the second sound. So, finish speaking. We should link the sounds and focus on the S. Finish speaking. Finish speaking. Finish speaking. Now, actually, when I say that, my SH is there. It's not very long. But the speaking S is much stronger. Finish speaking. Finish speaking. Finish speaking. The S, finish speaking, 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 is definitely stronger. It's very tough. Now, the other way is easier. Was Shane, I'll say it quickly, was Shane, was Shane, was Shane. In this situation, you do not hear the Z at all. It completely links into the SH and we keep the SH sound, okay? So once again, the general rule is when you have two similar sounds next to each other, link the sounds and focus on the second sound. Okay? That's a pretty safe rule. Okay, and we do have one more question. And this question is from Dongchul. Dongchul is asking me, he has two questions about my perf classes. So this is a great time for me to talk about PERF. Perfect English. This is my new internet class. I'm so excited. It's all about speaking. Perfect English is a class to teach you how to speak. P-I-R-F. PERF. P-I-R-F. P, pronunciation. I teach standard American pronunciation. P-I-R-F. I, intonation. Which words to stress. P-I-R-F. R, rhythm. How to group words together. When to pause. P-I-R-F. F, flow. How fast or how slow to speak. This is what I focus on. Sometimes we use a conversation, sometimes part of an interview, sometimes a paragraph. It's always different. It's always exciting and very important to practice these different styles in your speaking. So it's a very detailed class. And most of you probably know, I have three lessons, PERF 1, 2, and 3. And I am more than happy to give you those three classes. If you have not received those three lessons, send me an email. The email address is perfectenglish@gmail.com. Once again, it's PIRFECTENGLISH, perfectenglish@gmail.com. Send me an email. In the subject line, write PIRF and I will send you the three lessons for free, okay? And those are great lessons. They're very beneficial lessons. So, Dongchul has a question about PERF, and his questions are, can you teach us the British pronunciation also? Sometimes I hear you mimicking the British accent, and it's interesting to me. I would like to learn both accents, if possible.
Dongchul, I am sorry. In Japanese, watashi wa sorry desu.
That was a really bad joke. I'm sorry. Now, I would love to be able to teach the British accent. However, I do not properly speak the British English. And actually, there are very many different types of British English. I would love to be able to speak the Queen's English, but I can't. I can mimic it, but I don't actually know the proper rules for the pronunciation. So, unfortunately, I'm not qualified. So, no, I will not do that. Now, sometimes I might mention British English or British English styles. But once again, if you really want to master British English and the pronunciation, I highly recommend that you find a British teacher. And I'm sure there are very many on the internet.
Isn't the British English, doesn't it sound nice? It doesn't sound friendly, but it sounds intelligent. Right. Now, Dong Chol has another question. Will you give us feedback if I record myself reading the perf assignment? Great question. And the answer is yes and no. What? Okay, so people who join perf, I want all of you to send me a recording of the assignment. Now, I beg everybody to not say anything extra or stuff like that. Just focus on the assignment because I do listen to all the recordings. Okay? But, for example, when I gave out these free lessons, how many recordings do you think I got? So many. So it's impossible for me to give feedback to everyone. I can't. It's impossible. However, people who join perf, every week I will pick at least two people, probably three people, and sometimes four people, maybe more if it's a short assignment. Those four people I will give personal feedback to. And every week, those four people will be different. Now, what's going to happen? It will be randomly chosen. So the chance for you to be picked twice in a month, it's possible, but not really likely. But for you to get picked once, it's very, very possible. And I promise, I listen to everybody's assignment, and we will get everybody in there. I guarantee if you join, if you're a member for a long time, you will get your personal feedback on the recording, but not every week. It's just impossible. It's impossible for me. However, and I'll tell you this, Tong Chol, if by some miracle of God that Let's Master English grows and I am able to hire another native English, American speaking English teacher, then the possibilities are so much greater. I would love to hire some American dude to help me evaluate all of the recordings and really give that good one-on-one coaching, which is necessary. But I can say that, yes, I will get you for sure at least once. If you're lucky, once a month, probably once every couple of months. That's what you can probably think of. And so, I'm so excited about perf, everybody. Let me tell you about perf in a second. Once again, thank you so much for listening to the podcast. I was talking about perf, and we've started. We're open. October 2nd is the official first lesson for official perf members. And if you join now, oh boy, we have a very, very special discount. It's an amazing discount, and it's my great pleasure to offer this special discount to you. If you join, it's a subscription. You'll get charged every month, but that price will never go up. So, 10 years later, when the cost of perf is $59 a month, you will not be paying that. You will be paying that unbelievably low price, and it's my gift to you. You guys have helped me build this class, and I'm very pleased. I'm very happy with the class. Your feedback was so important, and I'm happy. So I want you to join. Now, I'm going to give you the website where you can join, and it's complicated. I apologize. We will have an easier system, but right now, this is Listen carefully. Are you ready? All right, so I'm going to read it once quickly, and then I'll go slowly. So listen carefully here. letsmasterenglish.leadpages.net/PIRF. Okay, so let me read that again. letsmasterenglish.leadpages, that's LEADPAGES.net, NET, /PIRF. Not too bad, right? Yeah, it's not too bad. letsmasterenglish.leadpages.net/PIRF. And about 3 or 4 days, I think, I will leave this special price up there. So if you're listening to this podcast after October 5th, 2014, I'm sorry. So sorry. No. The price is still low. I think everybody will be very pleased. I wanted to keep the price as low as possible so that everybody can get this chance to be coached on this personal level, okay? I want you guys, remember, to be a successful PIRF student, you need, and I know it's embarrassing, but you need to record yourself and send it to me. By the way, the easiest way to record yourself is with a smartphone. So if you have a smartphone, it's easy. Record yourself and then send that file to perfectenglish@gmail.com. Okay? That's for the members, just the members. Okay? But that's so important. You need to do that. You have to do that. And like I said, every week I'm going to pick a couple of you and give you real specific information on how you can master your speaking. So check that page out, letsmasterenglish.leadpages.net/PIRF. It has all the information, and of course it has the registration information too. And if there's any problems, any questions, send me an email. The email address is perfectenglish@gmail.com. That's P-I-R-F-E-C-T, English, perfectenglish@gmail.com. All right. Wow. That's it. I'm excited. This has been such a busy, 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 busy month. And I need a vacation. All right, you guys, that's it. You guys have a fantastic week. I apologize for being a day late this week. Just no memory in my account. So now we have spent more money. It's not cheap. We spent $60 this month to expand our memory. So that will be good. Money well spent, we hope. So anyway, next week I promise to get it up sooner. Thanks so much, you guys. Have a fantastic week, and together, let's master English!